Good morning, dear students. This is Amrita BL from AAC Independent PU College, Department of Biology. So in my last video session, I have taught you about the number of species estimation on global biodiversity and biodiversity in India. So in today's session, let us know about three important concepts that are pattern of biodiversity, species area relationship and importances of biodiversity. So talking about the patterns of biodiversity, so what do you mean by pattern? So in general, pattern means it is a particular way to do something or to organize some things, right? So pattern of biodiversity is nothing but it is the distribution of species of plants and species of animals throughout the world. So that is known as pattern of biodiversity. However, this distribution of plants and animals is not consistent throughout the world. It shows only an uneven distribution. So there are five interesting patterns of biodiversity, such as latitudinal gradient, altitudinal gradient, geographical gradient, topographical gradient, and humidity gradient. Among these five, the most well defined and well known pattern is latitudinal gradient till date. So here we will be concentrating more on latitudinal gradient than the other four types. So what do you mean by latitude and gradient? So in your lower classes, you might studied about longitude and latitude. So latitudes are nothing but, so these are the lines which runs parallel to the equator or which runs from east to west is known as latitude. So what you call it as sleeping lines, right? So longitude is nothing but, so these are the lines which runs perpendicular to the axis or which runs from north pole to the south pole is known as longitudinal. Then what do you mean by gradient? So gradient is nothing but it is the transition between the highest and lowest will tell us about the gradient. So what do you mean by latitudinal gradient? So we all know that the diversity of living forms or the species diversity will decrease as we move away from the lower axis to the higher axis or from the low altitude to the high altitudes. I repeat the point. The diversity of living forms will decrease as we move away from the low to the high altitude. So what does the low altitude represent here? The low altitude means equator and the high altitude represents here the polar regions, the northern pole and the southern pole. So I can also define it as the diversity of living forms decreases as we move away from the equator region or as we move towards the polar region, the number of species diversity or the diversity of the living forms gradually decreases. So as you can see in the image, the species diversity shows maximum near the equator region. Okay, there is a greater quantity of species diversity in the equator region. So you all can see that an imaginary line which is drawn at the center is the equator, right? The species diversity is widened or it is bigger or it is high in the equator region. So as we move away from the equator region, that is what we have studied in the latitudinal gradient, right? So the species diversity decreases as we move away from the equator. Okay, so in the same image you can see the species diversity is higher or it is more in the equator region. As we move away from the equator region, the species diversity is getting narrower or the species diversity is becoming very few, or drastically the number of species or species diversity is showing a gradual reduction. Okay, so that is about the image here. So if we take an example of the global north, so there are three important zones that are related to the climatic conditions. They are mentioned as tropical zone, temperate zone and polar zones. So here you can locate the tropical zone, which you can see near the equator, that is 0 degree, and just above the tropical zone You can see the temperate zone, so it is around 30 degree north, and slightly above the temperate zone you can also point out the polar zone, so that is around 60 degree north. The same thing implies on the southern pole as well. So here we have talked about the northern pole. The same thing, the tropic zone, temperate zone and the polar zones are similar on the southern pole also. So near to the equator you can see the tropical zone, and around 30 degrees south you can see the temperate zone, and 60 degrees south you can see the polar zone. So in the same image, so the last one that we have studied about the latitudinal gradient, we can be represented here. Okay, the biodiversity is minimum in the Arctic region and it is moderate in the temperate zone. So here the moderate means it is average in number, that means it is not too less neither too high, okay, it is in average range. Then the maximum biodiversity can be located in the tropical zone. So where you can locate the tropical zone? The tropical zone is in the equator region, right? So that is why the biodiversity is maximum. Where you can locate the, since we are moving away from the equator region, that means the second region is temperate zone. What happens to the biodiversity here? The biodiversity will be average. So again we are moving away from the equator to the polar zone, the biodiversity is minimal. Okay, so that is about the image here. And in the same figure I have also located three different arrow marks. So firstly, about the blue arrow mark indicates the Colombia region, okay. So the Colombia region is present in the tropical zone. So what will be the biodiversity here? Definitely it will be maximum. So the Colombia region, which is located near the equator, has nearly 1400 species of birds. So here based on the number of species we are talking about. Secondly, it is the temperate zone, which is in green color. Okay, the green color indicates the New York City. So the New York City is located in the temperate zone. So what happens to the biodiversity here? The biodiversity is moderate. Okay, the number of species here is about 105 species. So 105 species of birds are located in the New York City. Then again we are moving away from the equator, that is yellow arrow mark. The yellow arrow mark indicates Greenland. Okay, so Greenland, which is located in the polar zone, what happens to the biodiversity again here? Definitely it will gradually decrease. The Greenland will show about 56 species of birds. So that is about the image here. Then in the same image you can also locate the India. Okay, the majority portion of land area of India, that is our country, is covered, the maximum land area of our country is situated in the equator region, or it is in the tropical region. So definitely the number of species here will be more. So it is about 1200 species of birds are located, or more than 1200 species of birds are located in the Indian region. Okay. Then, so in this figure you can see red highlighted area, so that is known as Amazon rainforest. So we all know that it is the largely tropical rainforest, which is located in South America, and it has the greatest biodiversity, and it is also a home to more than 40,000 species of plants, 3,000 species of fishes, 1,300 species of birds, 427 species of mammals, and 427 species of amphibians, and 378 species of reptiles, and there are about more than 125,000 species of invertebrates. So for this reason the Amazon rainforest is also known as the lungs of the earth. So far we have been studied, we have been telling that the tropic zones have the highest, or it has the greatest biodiversity. here are some of the reasons to prove that the biodiversity is much more or it is greater in the tropical zone only. So the first reason mentioned here is the constant temperature and climate. So the tropical areas have more stable climate and temperature compared to that of the temperate zone and the polar zone. Whereas in the temperate zone or in the temperate area, they have the severe climate, and with that severe climate will make the organisms to live very hard. It becomes very hard for animals to get adapted to such conditions and then survive in extreme conditions. Whereas in the tropical area, they provide a favorable condition and it provides or it creates a conducive reproductive environment for the animals. So that is why the tropic zone has the greatest biodiversity because of its constant temperature and the constant climatic condition. The second reason is glaciation. So before going to the glaciation, what do you mean by glaciation? So glaciation is a condition where a masses of ice or what you call it as glaciers are being covered. So that state is called as glaciation. Okay, the temperate zones and the polar zones are at the higher risk of glaciation compared to the tropical zones, whereas these tropical zones are usually undisturbed from the glaciation. So this is the second reason why tropics have the greater biodiversity. The third reason is the solar energy. We all know that the sun is the supreme energy or it is the supreme power for many of our activities. For plants, it helps in photosynthesis, and for animals, it helps in foraging and migration. Foraging is nothing but searching for food. Okay, so there is more solar energy available in tropic zones, which contributes to the higher productivity. So this higher productivity will leads to a providing a perfect niche to all the living organisms, and thereby it imparts to a greater biodiversity. So these are the three main reasons why tropic zones have greater biodiversity. The first reason, they have the constant temperature and constant climatic conditions. Secondly, the tropic zones are safe from glaciation. Thirdly, about the more solar energy that are being contributed to the tropic zones. So coming to the second concept, that is species area relationship. So please mark these concept as important for your examination, and they may ask this question for 3 marks or 5 marks. So, as the name itself suggests, species area, it is something to do with number of species and area, okay? So, if you increase the area of research or if you decrease the area of research is nothing but explored area. So, the place where you will be going to investigate or you will be going to do research, okay? That area is known as explored area or area of research. Okay, if you increase or decrease the area of research, what will be the impact on species diversity? So that concept is called as species area relationship. So the great German geographer and naturalist Alexander von Humboldt observed the relationship between an area and species richness. So what do you mean by species richness? In my first video, I have told you about the species richness. So species richness is nothing but the number of species that are present within a unit area is called as species richness. So if you take an example of Western Ghats, so let us consider the Western Ghats as a unit area. Okay, so how many number of plant species and how many number of animal species are accommodating in that area will tell us about the species richness. Okay, so according to Alexander von Humboldt, he observed that within a region, the species richness increases with increasing explored area, but only up to a certain limit. That means the number of species will increase with increasing the area of research or the explored area. Okay, so that simply means that species diversity is directly proportional to the explored area, or what you call it as area of research. So let us understand this concept by taking an example. So in this image you can see four concentric circles. So the first one is blue circle, then red, then green and yellow. Okay, so if we consider the smallest area as A, and we will be considering the largest area as D. Okay, according to Humboldt, the species diversity increases when you increase the area of research, right? So now let us consider a small area A, which is blue in color. Okay, then large area called B, which is red in color, and larger area C, which is green in color, and largest area D, which is yellow in color. Okay, according to Humboldt, if you do research on area A, you will find some species. Okay, so we are talking about smallest area, that is A. Okay, so here if you do a research on area A, you will find some species. Say for example, you find 5 species. Okay, now if you increase the area from A to B, okay, if now you are increasing the area of research to B, okay, here also you will find some of the species. Okay, the number of species will also increase, say for example 10 species. Okay, similarly from area B to area C, so again you are increasing or you are expanding the area of research, the species diversity will also increase. Okay, so say for example the species will be 20. So in the small area you have found out 5 species, then in the large area you have found 10 species, and in the larger area C you have found 20 species. But when you increase the area after certain limit, okay, so now from C to D, if you increase the area from C to D, what should have happened? Definitely the number of species must increase. Okay, in the second half of the observation of Alexander von Humboldt, he also mentioned that the number of species will not increase after certain the limit. Okay, so we are talking about that. So when you increase the area after certain limit, you may not find that much species. So the number of species becomes steady, or increase in number of species becomes very less. So when it expanded from area C to D, the number of species will drastically reduce. Say for example, the number of species that you have found in area D is only 22. Actually, the number of species has to be doubled. In area C, the number of species that you have found was 20. In area D, the number of species has to get doubled. But what is happening here? The number of species is drastically reduced. Say for example, 22. Okay. So what Alexander von Humboldt said that, Alexander von Humboldt said that the area or the number of species increases with increase in area of research up to a certain limit. Okay, the same thing we are now interpreting the same in the form of graphical representation. Okay, the species richness on y-axis and area on x-axis. Okay, if you plot a graph based on the above learnt example, we will get a rectangular hyperbola. So that you can see a small curve which is represented in blue color. Okay, the equation of this hyperbola is S is equal to CA to the power Z. It is not S is equal to CA square, it is S is equal to CA to the power Z. Okay, so it is very difficult for us to find the exact number of species taking an example of rectangular hyperbola, or by taking the hyperbolic curve. So let us now convert this hyperbolic curve to a straight line. Okay, so we can convert this hyperbolic curve to a straight line equation by taking log on the above equation. okay, if we take log on both the sides, that is LHS as well as on the RHS, we will find log S is equal to log C plus Z log A. So this is same as your logarithmic formula, log MN is equal to log M plus log N, and log M to the power N is equal to N log M. Okay, so where S is the species richness, C is the y intercept or what you call intercept on y axis, and Z is the regression coefficient, or simply you can call it as slope of a line, and A is the area. So the above equation is log S is equal to log C plus Z log A. Now, what is this Z, or what is this regression coefficient or the slope of the line? So this value will differ from one area to the other area. Okay, the value of Z is found to lie in the range of 0.1 to 0.2 for smaller areas like some of the countries. If the area is small, the regression coefficient value will also lie in a smaller value. So here, if we are taking, we are talking about some of the countries, okay, if we take an example of some country, the value of Z is found to lie in a range of 0.1 to 0.2, okay. If we consider some of the large continent or the entire continent, the value of Z, that is regression coefficient, will lie in the range of 0.6 to 1.2. So, if we increase or if we expand the area of research, the value of Z will also increase, okay. Here is one example. So, the frugivorous birds, or what you call it as fruit eating birds, and the mammals which are living in tropical forest of different continent. Here we are talking about different continent, definitely the value of Z will be much more higher. Okay, the frugivorous birds and mammals living in the tropical forest of different continents will have a regression coefficient of about 1.15. Okay, so these values are important for your competitive exams. I hope this concept is clear. It is very simple. If you increase the area of research, it is directly proportional. That means it is the number of species will also increase, but only to a certain limit, okay. Then, so moving on to the next concept, that is importances of species diversity. So we all know that the species diversity plays an important role in an ecosystem or in an ecological balance of the ecosystem. Firstly, the biodiversity is somehow related with overall health of our ecosystem, and it makes the good thing, or it makes the survival of human beings on the earth. Secondly, it ensures a strong support for all the life forms. And thirdly, the increase in diversity will result in increasing productivity. So, biodiversity leads to the higher productivity. So, this ecosystem that contains more species are more productive than those with the less species. That means if we have more species in a community, that will fetch us the highest or the more productive or more productive things. And that of the less species, if we have more species, we are getting more benefit from those. If we have less species, there are no much productive items. Then the species diversity plays a major role in maintaining the ecological balance of the ecosystem, like food chain or food web, what you call, okay. All these will be in an ecological balance in an ecosystem. So that makes, if the species diversity is appropriate, it makes the smooth functioning of the ecosystem. So, in comparison to understand the importance of the biodiversity, so the Paul Ehrlich, an ecologist, developed the hypothesis called Rivet-Popper hypothesis. So, this Rivet-Popper hypothesis is also important for your examination. So, please note it as important. So, according to this hypothesis, So consider an airplane. Okay, consider an airplane. Here, airplane is related as, or it is considered as, ecosystem. Okay, according to Paul Ehrlich, so he relates, or he relates airplane as an ecosystem. Okay, this airplane is made up of millions of rivets. So an airplane is made up of millions of rivets. Okay, rivets are nothing but a short metal pin, or what you call it as, bolt, for holding two plates together. Okay, in the image you can see, the above image is airplane, which is considered as ecosystem, and just below the image you can see one more image, that is rivets. These are the rivets which are considered as species. Okay, according to Paul Ehrlich, airplane is considered as ecosystem, and the bolts which are made, the bolts are considered as the species. Okay, now if every passenger who is traveling in airplane starts to take off or pop the rivets, okay, if every individual who is traveling in airplane starts to take off all the rivets to the home. So what would be the scenario here? So according to Paul Ehrlich, that is, rivets are considered as species, isn't it? So it causes species to become extinct. Okay, each one of the individual who is traveling in airplane will try to take off the rivets or the small metal pins to the home. So what happens here? We have the Paul Ehrlich has considered rivets as species. Okay, so due to the loss of species, what happens? All the species that are present in ecosystem will become extinct. Okay, initially it may not affect the flight safety. That means he is going to tell that there is a proper functioning of ecosystem initially. So out of large species, if each one of the individual is trying to take out one of the species, it does not create any difference, or it does not create any much difference initially. But as more and more rivets are popped off, or more and more rivets are taken home, so what happens? Definitely the plane becomes weak. By this he means that the species become endangered. Okay, so more and more rivets are popped, that means more and more species are taken out from the ecosystem. So what happens? The species become endangered. So what do you mean by endangered? Endangered is nothing but near to the danger. And finally it becomes extinct. Extinct is nothing but, that means they are completely lost. Okay, he also then adds that the loss of rivets on major part of the aeroplane, so the major parts of the aeroplane is nothing but the wings and the elevators. So what happens if more and more rivets are taken out from the major parts of the aeroplane, such as wings? Definitely it causes more serious problem, or it creates more serious threats than losing the rivets on the lesser important parts. So the lesser important parts of airplanes are like seats, windows, cabinets and things like that. The major part of the aeroplane is wings. So what happens if every individual tries to pop out the rivets from the important part, or the major part of the airplane? That leads to the, what happens? Definitely it leads to the damage of the aeroplane. That means aeroplane is regarded as ecosystem. Okay, so by this he tells that the ecosystem plays an important role, and by this hypothesis it is clearly understood that the biodiversity has an, so the biodiversity has a significant role to play in our lives. So with this I have completed the first half of the chapter. That is, in this chapter we have talked about the meaning, definition, then we have also talked about the types of biodiversity along with the examples, then we have talked about global biodiversity and the biodiversity in India, and today we have talked about the patterns of biodiversity, secondly species area relationship, and thirdly it is Rivett-Popper hypothesis. The species area relationship and Rivett-Popper hypothesis are important for your examination point of view. So thank you, dear students.